our time of worship. If you remember here, there's a voting table at the end of the hall. Make sure you grab your ballot. We'll be voting on our pastor search team today. But more importantly, we're here to worship the Lord together as his people. Let's have a good time together. Words will be on the screen. This is going to be our call to worship this morning. Let's just remove all distractions, turn off our cell phones, get our bulletin, do whatever we need to if you're ready for what the Lord has for us today.
Sunday, so we need some volunteers for that. And then, of course, Easter is right around the corner. Be thinking of some people to invite to Easter. We always have a big service on Easter. And next Sunday, we're going to have lunch right after church. We're going to have a chili lunch. There's going to be a sign-up sheet right after service if you want to bring sides or chili. It's not a chili cook-off. There's no contest. If you make bad chili, just bring it. We don't care. It's not a contest. We're just going to have a sign-up sheet on the back. And so please just bring food and stay after. We're just going to have a good time. Today we're going to be looking at a very famous story in the scriptures where it's a fun story where guys cut through a man's roof to get a friend to Jesus. And I'm going to tell you what I think is the most fascinating thing about this story that most people gloss over if they're reading the story too fast. And so we're going to be looking at that here in just a short moment. We're also going to have some more singing, and we're going to be looking at some mission moment from our missions team in just a few moments. So we're so glad that you're here, and we're just going to have a good time praising the Lord today and looking into Scripture. But before we start, let's have a moment of prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just love you. We just thank you for every home that's represented here today. We just thank you, Lord, how you've been with us. And Lord, we just want to take a moment just to say thank you for how you bless us, how you're always there. You know all the problems, issues, things that are going on in our lives, and we just thank you that we do not go through life alone. I pray, Lord, that everything we do today honors you and pleases you. And we just want to take this moment to praise your name. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us today, and we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Continue singing. A reminder, a good time to turn off your cell phones, and let's just give God the glory he deserves. Let's stand together and sing that. To God be the glory for the great things he has done.
Thank you.
prayer for North America and North American missionaries and North American church planters and all the ministries that go on here on our own continent. And you'll see in your bulletin some information about things you can do this summer right here. But right now, this month, we're going to pray and we're going to act in accord with many other churches across our country and across the world and do things to build bridges into our community. All over the world and all of our country, churches and new church planters are having Easter egg hunts. And while it has nothing to do with the resurrection of Jesus, it is a bridge we can build that can help us speak of the gospel and speak of Jesus. The legacy we want to leave is that we built a bridge to hearts and Jesus walked over. And this is something we can do and that we do have done every year for several years. You can pre-register your children using these sheets that are out on the foyer table out there. You can pre-register your children, your grandchildren. Do not register anybody without their parents knowing. We have one bad Google review, and it has to do with a child getting mail from us that someone registered someone and their parents didn't know. So this is a very serious matter. We don't want to ever violate a family's standard of privacy on that. So you have to have permission of the parent in order to register them. And so you'll want to pick that up. If you pre-register, this all goes faster. It is on Palm Sunday. We always do it on Palm Sunday, and it's at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. There are also some beautiful little flyers you can give out and invite people. So you may want to think, I'm going to invite my 5 neighborhood kids, take the parents a registration form, take a flyer, and invite. And it's going to be good. It's always fun. We're going to need 4,000-ish eggs. So don't bring them to me tomorrow. I will lose my mind. So I don't have any place to put 4,000 eggs. So the week prior is when you need to bring them, and then they can sit on these seats all week, and it'll be just fine. So we are going to need eggs. We're going to need sides, you know, things like Little Debbie packets and cookie packages and chips and that kind of thing. And Miss Denise has said she would, again, help us organize the food. So we just need those sides to go in the bags. There's a big flyer if you need one for, I don't know, where you want to put it, on your front door or at your workplace or whatever. There are a few big flyers if you want that. And there's a sign-up sheet back on that famous bulletin board where all the sign-up sheets are for chili and for retreats and all the stuff back there on the bulletin board. And you can sign up to help, and we'll be in touch. We need people to put eggs out. We'll probably go out in shifts. We're going to need people to make sure kids get bags. More than anything, we need friendly faces, friendly people to stand and greet as part of the bridge building. And I'll tell you a story about that. We had a girl come to bring her child to daycare from the neighborhood one time. And she said, I can't come here before. I came to things you had on the lawn, was how she explained it. And to VBS, I think. And she said, I would come over. And then one Sunday morning, my girlfriend spent the night, and we said, hey, let's go over to church. And so we went over. They felt comfortable because they had been here. But then when they got back home, the parents were awake and said, well, where were you? They thought they were still sleeping. And she said, well, we just went over to church. And the parents said, you can't just go over there like that. We don't go there. But the little girl thought she did go here. You know, so we don't ever want to be a country club, right? Where the people in the neighborhood need to feel free to come. And we want the kids to feel free and free enough that she came again when she was grown up and brought her child. So we just want to pray we'll be those people that when we get out on the lawn like that, that the neighbors know that we're their neighborhood church and they can come over. So let's pray together that the Lord will help us and help all people everywhere who are building bridges right now in the spring season. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you that you love us. I thank you that we have run from the darkness into your marvelous light. And I pray that we will be a lighthouse right here. And I pray that we will find ways to build bridges into our neighborhood so that they can meet you. Help us, Lord, always to be bridge builders, not bridge burners. And I do pray that we will be your light and your grace in this dark world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, we're going to continue in worship, and all the children up through grade 6 can go in this Nicole Lake group in the back for the children's church. We're going to continue to sing a song called Days of Elijah, and we're going to invite you to stand with us as we sing this song. It's going to be on the screen.
Respecting us, even though some of us can't sing. On that last, on one of those slides, it said, key change. That means nothing to me. I sing one key and it's off key, and so that meant nothing to me. Another thing, as I said, my mind doesn't think like most people. I'm watching, this is the third drummer since I've been here that we use. In most churches, I don't know if you guys, I've been in a lot of churches, and almost every church I've been in, they put that plexiglass around them. You know what I'm saying? I've seen some head shake. They put plexiglass around them, and so they always cage the drummer in. And so I'm sitting there looking, and I'm thinking, all three of our drummers are skinny. So we have three range drummers. I think that's why they're skinny, because they're free range. I like our drummers. You know, I'm normally not for free range. I hate free range chicken. I like fat chicken. Don't you? Nothing makes me more angry when I go to a chicken place and they give me little skinny drumsticks, you know. I like fat chicken, but I like our skinny drummers. They're all pretty good. I don't know. See, that's just what, you know, all of our minds race sometimes, so I just tell you we're normal too, preachers are. So, all right. Hopefully your minds will stay with me as we get into our scriptures here. All right. Just let you know where we are. We are in still in Capernaum for the next 2.5 years. This is the home base for Jesus. He's going to come in and out of Capernaum. And so I just want you to know that if you can find the Sea of Galilee on that map and go to the very top of the Sea of Galilee, you will see Capernaum. And that is where we are. And so I'm going to show you some pictures in a moment of where we think this story is taking place, all right? And so what does the Bible say is where we always start? And Matthew and Mark, this story is also in Matthew and Mark, and they're going to continue showing a string of miracles. And last week I said that Mark has more miracles in his story than Matthew and Luke does. And so Mark is basically using miracles to do sermons. And he is using, because he's preaching primarily to Romans, and he is not using sermons, he's using miracles to give a sermon. And so Matthew is cutting out all the essentials. And Matthew is always referring a lot to the Old Testament because he's talking to Jewish people, and they understand that. And so we're going to see here that Matthew is not even going to mention the forgiveness of sins, because Jews know that man cannot forgive sins. And so he's not even going to mention that as we get further on in this story. And so Luke is now going to show this miracle with a darker side of Jesus' ministry, the side of rejection. And we're going to start seeing here that he's going to build on that rejection until we get to the crucifixion. And we're going to start seeing where Jesus is going to be renowned for doing miracles, but that's not why Jesus came. He came for people to follow him and repent of their sins and realize that he is the Messiah. But people are seeing him more as a miracle worker, and that's not what Jesus wanted. And so I want to just start this passage with two verses in Mark, and just to give us the surrounding context. And so Mark just says this: when Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon, the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors, there was no more room, even outside the door. One of the problems you have when you become a celebrity, and I've heard celebrities talk about this in interviews, is that You go to a restaurant and people will come up to you. They want an autograph. They want a picture. You have no privacy. And so Jesus now, because he has done these miracles, we've already seen where he has healed the man with leprosy. He was in church in Capernaum, and he cast a demon out of a guy. And all of a sudden, this news is spreading everywhere. And so because this is happening, all of a sudden, people know of Jesus. And this is happening on the main trade route right here in Capernaum. And so this news is spreading everywhere. And so people are coming to see Jesus. He is this huge celebrity. They're not coming to worship him. They're coming to see him do more miracles. And so here he is in a house, and people are packed in. They're packed in. Now, I want to just show you some pictures of this in Capernaum. And the first picture, that circle there at the top, you see the water at the north part of this picture. That is the Sea of Galilee. And that circular part there is that roof there is a church. Now, one of the interesting things when you go to the Holy Land, and I hope you, if you have any opportunity to go with me, I'll take you to the Holy Land in one of my tours. When we go, if you see a church, an evangelical church, a Catholic church, a Protestant church, anywhere in the Holy Land, there is probably someone thinks something happened there. Something is special about that spot. And here is where they believe Peter's house was. Now, what's interesting here is they built a church on top of Peter's house. And I'm going to show you that in a moment. Most of the time, they build the church next to the site. Here, they build it right on top. Now, if you go south a little bit on this, you're going to see a building without a roof. That is the synagogue. Now, that would not be the synagogue that Jesus spoke in, because this is a synagogue that was built after Jesus, but this would have been a synagogue built on the synagogue that Jesus would have spoken. So when you walk around that synagogue, you would be actually walking in the space where Jesus would have taught, which is kind of cool, all right? So you can see how close the synagogue was to Peter's house. And they have done a ton of excavation there at Peter's house, and they have found things with Peter's name on it. There was also, through history, they turned that house into a church. And so there's a lot of reasons why they believe that was Peter's house. And then here is the... something happened here? There we go. There is the church on top of the excavation. And then these are my pictures. And this is called St. Peter's Church in Capernaum. And then here is some of the pictures that I have taken. And so you can see where the excavation is right under this church. This is a Catholic church where they have literally built it over what would be Peter's house. And one of the interesting things about this house is they have built rooms onto the house. So as Jesus started coming and then more disciples came, they would have had to keep building rooms onto this house. So it all fits the story of Jesus. And then when you get inside the church, you see that they have built a glass floor in the middle of it where you can look right inside of Peter's house. Kind of cool, huh? Yeah. And then this is where it's actually, you can see right inside. And so I actually sat through a church service in that church, and it's very beautiful. But it's just interesting that everywhere in the Holy Land, if there's a Catholic church or some kind of Protestant church, there's something happened there that they would thought was special. What was fascinating, if you want to know the history of why we know so accurately where these sites are, is that when the Romans came in AD 70 and kicked out the Jews out of Jerusalem, they tried to get rid of the Jewish religion. And so what they did is they went to all the holy sites for the Jews, and they put up Roman temples and thought, well, we'll get rid of the Jewish religion. And then when the Roman Empire became Christian, all they had done was bookmark all the Christian sites. So they just went back and turned those temples back into churches. So that's how we know where all these holy sites are. It's kind of cool. So I hope that whets your whistle to someday go with me to the Holy Land. We have a great time when we go. All right, back to our story. Now we get back to Luke. Now, verse 17 says, one day while Jesus was teaching, some Pharisees and teachers of religious law were sitting nearby. Now again, this is the same story. We're back in Luke, and Luke is telling it from a different angle. And it seemed that these men showed up from every village in all of Galilee and Judea, as well as from Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem would have been 70 miles away from Capernaum. And so the Pharisees are coming to check out this Jesus, because the word is spreading throughout all of Galilee and even into Judea about Jesus. And so the Pharisees, you know, they consider themselves the people who watch over the law. And so they're just making sure that Jesus is really teaching the right thing. A lot of times, the Pharisees get a bad take. You know, a lot of times we really give it to the Pharisees. And they did take a life of their own, because sometimes they just got so many rules that you couldn't even keep up with the rules. For instance, they had an oral tradition. For instance, in the Old Testament, it talks about the Sabbath, that you're not to work on the Sabbath. So what does that really mean? All right, it says in the Old Testament, it says don't work on the Sabbath. Well, the Jews got together, the Pharisees, and started thinking, all right, what does this mean, the rabbis? And they said, well, we need to put rules together. And so they made a document called the Mishnah. And if you're talking to a Jewish person, especially an Orthodox Jew, they would know what the Mishnah is. And the Mishnah is a document that has all the rules in it. And in the Mishnah, there is 24 chapters that explain the rules of how not to break the Sabbath. Now, isn't that kind of ridiculous? When you're in the Holy Land, when we're in the Holy Land on Sabbath is Friday evening to Saturday evening. There are different sets of elevators, and there is one set of elevators that this is how ridiculous. Now, again, I'm speaking as a Christian, and if you're Jewish here, I don't mean to offend you, but this is how ridiculous the rules are, that if they have more than one elevator, if there's only one, this elevator operates this way. But if there's more than one, only one elevator operates this way. It is set to stop at every floor, because it is work to push a button to say which floor you're going to. So therefore, we are told as guests, these are the elevators you use, or you're going to go to every floor. Yeah, that's work. Years ago, we had an Orthodox temple right behind my Bible college. And it was a Saturday afternoon, and I'm sitting on the stairs of our college with some other friends, and the tennis courts was right there. And a lady was walking to the temple for her service. and she was walking down the sidewalk, and a tennis ball came over the fence. And it rolled right in front of her on the sidewalk and stopped on the grass between the street and the sidewalk. Every one of you would have picked up the tennis ball and threw it back over the fence, because these guys behind the fence would have had to run out, and it would have been a pain for them to run out to get the ball. Every one of you would have just thrown it over. And she walked right past it. And then she had to walk right past me and a couple of my friends sitting on these stairs. And she got past us, and she knew. She wasn't a mind reader, but she knew that every one of us thought, that was kind of rude. And she stopped, and she turned around, and she said, I know that seemed rude that I didn't pick up that ball, but I am an Orthodox Jew on the way to service, and if I would have picked up that tennis ball and threw it back, that would have been considered work on the Sabbath. Now, I appreciated her trying to tell me why she wasn't being what you and I would have said kind, right? She was trying to be faithful to her faith. And so that just tells you how strict these people were in what they believed, and they were here to check out Jesus. And so, and most people trace the Pharisees back to Daniel and his three friends, all right? So it seems that these men showed up from every village in Galilee and Judea, as well as from Jerusalem. And then I want to read this last verse, because I want to make sure you understand this last sentence. And the Lord's healing power was strongly with Jesus. Now, this doesn't mean that Jesus' power was stronger that day than other days. His power didn't go up and down. His power was always strong, but Luke was just pointing out that Jesus had strong healing power. It just wasn't any stronger that day than other days. It wasn't stronger. He was just pointing out Jesus had strong healing power. Okay? All right, let's go on here. And then in verse 18 and 19... it says, some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a sleeping mat. We don't know how long he had been paralyzed. We don't know if he had been born paralyzed. We don't know if it was recent. We don't know anything about that. It says they tried to take him inside to Jesus, but they can't get inside the room. Now, we know from looking at Mark, if I would have read further in Mark, that the Pharisees were inside, and because they were the clergy, they had seats inside the house, and all the people of Capernaum were standing. But the Pharisees were sitting, and yet there was no more space inside this house. And again, I think it was Peter's house, because that would have just made more sense. It could have been any private residence. But it just would have made more sense that Jesus would have been at home and it would have been Peter's residence. But it was a private residence. Because we're going to see there were stairs outside of the house, it doesn't seem like he would have been at the synagogue. And it wouldn't have been set on the Sabbath. Again, that makes it not seem like it would have been the synagogue. And so we believe it's a private residence. I lean that it would have been Peter's house. But they couldn't reach him because of the crowd, verse 19. So they went up to the roof and took off some tiles. Now, taking off tiles, in those days, what you would have done on a roof is you would have beams laid down, and then you would have taken sticks and laid them crosswaves across the other direction. Then you would have taken dirt and compacted it down. And in those days, in the summertime, is you would walk down and looked at the houses, grass would have grown on top of the houses. And so these guys would have basically been doing a mini excavation. and the house's roofs would have been like 2 feet thick. So they're going to have to dig 2 feet deep to get through this roof, which means as they're digging, they get to a point, all of a sudden dirt is going to start falling in on the guys inside the house. I don't know about you, but if it would have been my house, I've been a little ticked. You're going to tear up my roof to get somebody in my house, right? There's nothing here that they said, excuse me. They just went upstairs. They were on a mission to get this guy to Jesus. And so then it says they lowered the sick man on his mat down into the crowd right in front of Jesus. And so what incredible friends. Now, they weren't coming to Jesus because of their theology. They weren't coming to Jesus because they thought he was God, because they didn't know Jesus well enough yet, theologically. They were coming to Jesus because of all the miracles that were spreading around. And they're like, if he can heal that guy, if he can make a leper cleanse, if he can take a demon out of a guy, if he can do this and this and this and this, hey, we got a buddy he can do something to. And so that's why they're coming to Jesus, is to get their buddy healed. All right? So that's what they're doing, is bringing their buddy. And so, I just want to say, do you have any friends like this? Mm-hmm. Man, wouldn't it be great to have friends that will destroy another person's property to get you to Jesus? I mean, these are good friends. I mean, this is impressive what these guys are doing. So, here's the thing. In verse 20, they lower this guy down, and they get him in front of Jesus. And everybody, you know, there's got to be people that are upset. They got dirt in their hair. They got to be upset. And Jesus is looking at the guy, and he is so impressed with the friends. He says, seeing their faith, the friend's faith, not the guy's faith. Typically, he heals based on the person. He says, seeing their faith, Jesus said to the man, young man, your sins are forgiven. Now, I think Jesus was always poking the bear. Y'all have a friend like that? I got a friend. I'm one of those guys. I poke the bear whenever I can, right? I like poking the bear. Jesus is poking the bear. He's got all these religious guys in the house. And he knows what he's about to do is to tick them off. What he just did here is considered blasphemy. In fact, the reason Jesus got crucified is for this right here. Jesus got crucified for saying he was God. He didn't do anything wrong. He just said he was God. That's why the Jews, the Pharisees, wanted him crucified. And so he says, right here in front of these religious guys, he says, young man, your sins are forgiven. This guy and his friends didn't bring this guy to Jesus to get his sins forgiven. They brought him to Jesus to get healed. So in a sense, this almost seems like Jesus was not being nice to them, right? And so as we go on, and this is where Matthew skips this. Matthew doesn't even put it in because Matthew is writing to Jews, and he knows his writers already know this. To him, this is just redundant to put it in Scripture. But to Mark and Luke, who is writing to Romans and to Gentiles, they want to make sure their writers get this. Verse 21 says, but the Pharisees and teachers of the religious law said to themselves, Who does he think he is? That's blasphemy. Only God can forgive sins. Only God can forgive sins. And I want to be careful here not to be too hard on the Pharisees, because in the Old Testament, forgiveness of sins was never, ever attributed to the Messiah. Never attributed to the Messiah. And so the Pharisees are upset that he's basically saying he's God, and yet in the Old Testament, the Messiah was never said that he would forgive sins. Let's go on to verse 22. It says, Jesus knew what they were thinking. So he asked them, why do you question this in your hearts? Is it easier to say your sins are forgiven or stand up and walk? Verse 24 says, so I will prove to you that the Son of Man has the authority on earth to forgive sins. Then Jesus turned to the paralyzed man and said, stand up, pick up your mat, and go home. And so this is fascinating to me, that he basically gives a parable and says, if I can heal the man, doesn't that prove that I can forgive his sins? And so that's what he's trying to do. And so that's what he's trying to say, that he can do this. And he's making it very clear that he is the Messiah. He also says in verse 24 that he's the Son of Man. And he knows that the Pharisees are going to catch this. The Son of Man is said about 80 times in the Gospels. And sometimes he uses the Son of God, but it's not frequently. It's the Son of Man, because in Daniel, the Son of Man refers to the Messiah. And so Jesus is saying, he loved to use the term Son of Man, and what he's saying to these people is, I'm going back, and Daniel referred to the Son of Man as the Messiah, and I'm the Son of Man. And when he uses the term Son of Man, it is basically referring to his humanity, and also that Daniel said that the Son of Man would also be the Messiah. And so it's important to realize that in the Old Testament, the Messiah would be not only human, but he would be superhuman. In the Old Testament, the Messiah would die, but he would also reign eternally. This was baffling to the Jews, and they didn't understand it. You and I get it, because we can look back and go, Jesus did die and rose again, and he's going to live eternally. We get it, because we have Scripture. To the Jews, it confused them. And so that's one of the issues that Jews have. I'll be honest with you. I'm glad I'm born now. I'm glad I wasn't one of the Jews then, because it would have confused me. And so I'm thankful that God put me here now. In verse 25, it says, and immediately as everyone watched, and we talked about this for the last couple of weeks, the man jumped up. He didn't need recovery time. He just jumped up, picked up his mat, and went home praising God. And everyone was gripped with great wonder and awe, and they praised God, exclaiming, we have seen amazing things today. Now, in this story, what's the most impressive thing to you? Some would say that these guys put a hole in a man's roof. Some would say that Jesus proved that he could forgive sins. Some would say that he healed the man, and the man immediately got up. Those are all impressive parts of this story. But that's not the most impressive thing to me in this story. The most impressive thing to me in this story is that Jesus proved that he could heal, that he could forgive sins. And what we see here is that no one asked Jesus to forgive them of their sins. Doesn't that blow you away? When I have two sons, and when we would be in a pool, dads can't help to do this. It's in our
dad's book of 101, you know? Class 101, when you're a dad, you gotta throw your boys in a pool. You just got to. And so you would grab your first son and you would throw him in a pool. And the second son always says this, "Do me, Dad, do me." And you would grab the second son and you would throw him, right? No one here says, "I just watch you forgive a man's sins. Do me. Do me." Isn't that mind-boggling? He just proved he can forgive sins. And everybody's in awe. And not one person walks up to Jesus and says, "Hey man, can you forgive me of my sins?" Not one person. That blows me away. Today you walk up to people and you say, "You going to heaven?" "Yeah, I think I am." "Well, that's awesome. Let me ask you something. When did you repent of your sins?" That's a question that a lot of people don't even know how to answer. You see, Jesus said, and John the Baptist said, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is coming." You can't be a believer until you first realize you need salvation. You can't be a believer unless you first repent and say, "I'm lost and I need to be saved. I'm lost and I need to be found." And yet we've got a ton of people in this world who are going to heaven, and yet they first have never admitted that they were lost and they actually need Jesus. They just say they're going to heaven because they claim they're a good person. Does that make sense? We have to realize that when we are compared side by side with Jesus and God, we're nothing. And we are lost people. And Jesus died on the cross for us. Let me wrap this up. How can you obey? Real quickly, being in awe of God is not the same thing as knowing God. Everybody left that household in awe of God, the Bible says. And yet not one person said, "Forgive me of my sins." Not even one of the four friends. Secondly, have you ever heard someone say this? "You know, I worship God in my own way. Hey, why don't you go to church with me?" "You know, I worship God my own way." You ever heard someone say that? I want you to understand it is God who determines what is satisfactory worship from his followers. God tells us that we are to worship him in spirit and truth. He tells us how we are to come together as believers. He tells us what we are to do in church. God tells us what we are to do. We don't make this stuff up. He tells us. And so we need to follow how he wants to be worshiped. And lastly, when people are confused about the true God and Jesus Christ, when gospel clarity is at stake, the proper response is a plain statement of the truth. 2 Corinthians 4:2 says, "We reject all shameful deeds and underhanded methods. We don't try to trick anyone or distort the word of God. We tell the truth before God, and all who are honest know this." The gospel is very simple. Only God could pay the price to make God happy for us to have eternal life. It's that simple. Jesus had to die on the cross for your and my sins. That's the only way it could work. And we need to keep the gospel very simple, very clear, so people understand it. We don't need to make it confusing. And you and I just need to trust what Jesus did for us, that we could have eternal life. It's not any harder than that. And once we understand that, a lot of people, this is what surprises me, a lot of people have a problem with the gospel is because it's so simple. And that's what makes Christianity, when anybody says this, and I'll wrap it up with this, people will say all religions are the same. And I always say, no, it's not. A lot of religions, including Christianity, strive for an outcome that's similar, about, you know, good, being good to fellow men, a lot of morality and things like that. But when it comes to how you get there, Christianity differs from every religion in the world. Every religion in the world. Because every other religion, you have to do something to achieve nirvana or heaven. And in Christianity, we don't do anything. It's God who did it for us. We're the only religion in the world where God did it for us. We go to heaven on what he did, not on what we do. Mm-hmm. Isn't that incredible?
Amen.
That's mind-boggling to me. Mm-hmm. I hope you think about this story, and the main thing I want you to remember is no one asked Jesus, do me, do me. And I hope you don't leave here without saying, do me, do me. Think about that this week. As we strive to become more like Christ, as we say it with me, study the Bible,
serve others, and share our faith together.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just love you. I am so thankful that those of us who are followers of you that have asked for repentance, we have repented of our sins and asked you to forgive us, that we go to heaven based on what Jesus did for us on the cross. He proved that he was God. In this case, he proved he was God because he made a man walk. But in our case, he proved that he was God, that he died, rose again. So he proved that he was God for us, that he lives forevermore. Father, I pray that no one leaves here today not knowing you as their Savior. Father, I pray that you just help us to tell more and more people this incredible news that you live and you want to live in our hearts and have a relationship with us. We love you and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The praise team is going to come and we're going to sing parts of a song. And if you stand with us and if you'd like to come forward and pray, we'd encourage you to do so. And we would like to give you this opportunity.
So there were two things that we were going to vote on today. Hopefully a couple of weeks ago you received a copy of the church ministry plan. This includes information about the health of the church, what is going on in the church, the status of some of the ministries, membership roles, includes the budget and other things, and just how the church is structured. If you didn't get a copy, you're welcome to the copy. They're on the back table. The other point that we're going to vote on, and we vote on this a couple times a year, just to see that we're all seeing how we're doing as a church, and we don't hide that. And the other point that we wanted to vote on today was the pastor search team, which is included, and there are 9 names that are listed in here that will be the pastor search team going forward from this point. Now, one of the things for clarity about the pastor search team, they will not select the next pastor. What they will do is bring a candidate they believe that God has led them to as a group of believers to this church, and then we will review, meet with them, and vote on this person after they've come and preached a couple of sermons and met us as a group and prayed about it. So it's a process. It's a process. It's going to take a while. It's going to take a few more months. But we're continuing to go as the normal process as a church. So is there any discussion on either the church ministry plan or the pastor search team?
Do we have the search team standing up that are here?
Oh, okay. Good.
Anybody else?
Nicole's teaching.
Nicole's in the back. Bill Jones on there. And myself.
And Warren Heslin is not here.
Warren, Megan Lyon. Okay. Thank you. So if there are no questions, that will be the vote. You will have a ballot. If you received a ballot, it says, I affirm the ministry plan for Memorial Baptist Church, yes or no. And I affirm the pastor search team as recommended by the elders and deacons, yes or no. Now, if you did not get a ballot and you're a church member, you can see Brother Leonard or Brother Dave after the service and we can sort that, you know, get you a ballot appropriately. So, if there are no other questions, can I have a motion to close the business meeting?
Amen.
Can I have a second?
Amen.
Okay, Steve Hine. Okay, all approved to close the business meeting? Okay, any opposed? There are not. Thank you.
All right, two things. One, if you did not get a ballot but would like to be a member of the church, please talk to myself or one of the deacons and we will help you start that process. Secondly, these people, you need to pray for these people who are going to be on the search team. This is hard work. In fact, if you don't like any of these people, vote yes to put them on the search team because it's so much hard work to be on a pastor search team. And so they have a lot of work in front of them. And then, so please pray for them for the next couple of months. This is going to be a lot of work. Thank you for being here today. Tonight is a bowling night for those of you on our bowling league, and we hope you have a wonderful day. Enjoy it.